Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome all of you this hot day, evening. Welcome here at St. Teresa's of the Congregate Church. I'm Father Sobi, the pastor of this congregation. The priests at the parish are Hungarian Jesuits since 1949. And the other priest is just sitting there. Past 8 years, and the third one just recently passed 91. So three of us try to serve the Hungarian congregation here. A very special and warm welcome to Father Andrew Blood. He's very well known among Hungarians. Translations of his works into Hungarian go back to the late 1980s. The late Father Jenő Vácz, you remember, a Hungarian Jesuit, started to translate Father Henry's lectures in 1986. Because of the publishing of his books, Father Bulat visited Hungary a couple of times. I had the chance to translate his live lectures in Budapest for university students, his interviews with the state television in the early 1990s. And Father Bulat was a very nice host to me in Alexandria at the end of the 1990s, showing through 2 days the beauties of his beloved city of birth, Alexandria. Dear Henry, I am so happy to meet you again on this other side of our sweet globe, far away from your home and mine. Turning to the topic of today's lecture, no wonder that you accepted the title to talk about it without any hesitation. I was surprised. I do not know yet what was in your mind reading what I suggested as a topic for today, but I hope that shortly I will know. So, for my part, theosis, in the title, theosis, the Christian way of divinization, is a beautiful approach toward the everyday life of Christ's family. In the Bible, the second letter of Peter, chapter 1, 3, 4, tells us Christ's divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through this, Peter goes on, through this, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, all of us, having escaped the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. The quote ends. There are so many other places in the Word of God speaking about our vocation as followers of Christ, namely to enter into the Trinitarian life, starting with the baptism and ending up in theosis. The patristic teachings, is it loud enough? Okay. The patristic teachings, the Eastern tradition, are full with beautiful testimonies about the deification or theosis. It refers to the attainment of likeness of God, union with God, and or reconciliation with God. Deification has three stages in its process of transformation, catharsis, theoria, and theosis. In the Western tradition, the name of the three stages are via purgativa, via illuminativa, and via unitiva. The Bible teaches that for those who really look for God in the everyday life, everything turns out to be a gain. With this in mind, we should face everything, even secularism and Islam. So, dear Father, what gain we could have by these, secularism and Islam? How do you see the world around us, thinking on our vocation and the invitation this day by day. So that's some introduction to your lecture and information. Just after the lecture, there will be a break for about 10 minutes. The washrooms are downstairs. And there will be time to ask the Father. The way how we will ask the Father is there are paper and pen for all of you to use if you would like. When I ask now Magdi to stand up, Bukovets Magdi, she has the pencil, pen, paper, so if you need. And during the break, write down your questions and give them to me. And I will manage the questions. Yeah. So, dear Father, the mic is yours.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Father. Thank all of you for coming and sharing this evening around the subject of theosis in our daily life, in the shadow of mosques and secular society. Theosis, as Father said, is the divinization of man. And this is the Oriental view of redemption. Redemption is a traditional way of speaking of the main role of Jesus. He came to redeem us from sin, to redeem the human being from original sin. And the stress has been so much put on original sin and redemption that we have lost the real goal of incarnation and Christ's life, which is theosis. Actually, I oppose the Western view and the Eastern view. You, as Hungarians, you are Orientals. You are the eastern part of Europe. And I went many times in Hungary, and I discovered that you have an eastern and oriental soul. It means that the stress in the West is put on the cross. The stress in the East is put on resurrection. The overwhelming insistence on cross in the West gave to the West a kind of a negative vision of life. Pessimistic vision of man. This man, when I speak of man, I mean the human being, not man as a male. This insistence on sin and atonement and redemption and original sin gave to most of Western Christians a negative view of themselves. We are bad people. Sin is in us. And Jesus came to redeem us from sin. And despite this redemption which took place, there is still an insistence on sin, on hell, on atonement, on culpabilization and feelings of that we are not good people. At the origin of this vision is Saint Augustine. Saint Augustine is at the roots of this Western vision of A man like Nietzsche, the famous philosopher, atheist philosopher, looking at the Christians, he said, they don't look like being saved. Salvation or redemption should appear in our faces, in our way of life. If you take the way of the cross, the way of the cross, the 14 stations of Jesus, they end in the tomb. Jesus is put in the tomb, and it looks like it's finished. Where is the resurrection? Jesus has risen, really, and why to stop at the 14th station? People forget that there is beyond that the living Christ. In our Byzantine rite, I am of Byzantine rite, Melkite Byzantine rite. The stress is put on the risen Christ. And even during the Holy Week, in the Good Friday, when we speak about the cross, immediately before waiting for Easter, before waiting 3 days later, we always speak about resurrection. And from the Saturday, we have an explosion of joy, which reaches its peak in Sunday, Easter Sunday. And all the people shout and cry and chant and sing in the churches, Christos Anestes. Christos Anestes. In Arabic, the Messiah come. And in the night of Easter, we find Christos Anestes, Nekron Tanato, Taranon Patisas, Ketis Etis Primas, Ido in Harisa. Christ has risen from the dead, and he has crushed death by his death. He has crushed it. No more death, no more evil, no more sin. He overcame sin. The triumph of Christ in Easter is the true, deep meaning of the cross. Why to stop at the cross? Why to concentrate on the cross? You have the cross, of course, in the altar, but behind it you have the risen Christ with open hands. This victory of Jesus over death, over evil, over sin, this is what means theosis. He came not to atone for our sins, but to bring us life. And he said it clearly, I came so that they could have life and life to the full. I came so that they could have life and the fullness of life. Fullness of life. And what is the fullness of life? It is divine life. Divine life, we are called to participate in God's life, in divine life. This is what we call Christian hope. Hope. And the end word, the last word of the creed is what I believe in the resurrection, dead and alive in the world to come. Amen. In the resurrection of the dead and alive in the world to come. Amen. In this vision, death does not exist. There is no something called death. Death does not exist. You may tell me, but someday I will die. We are created for everlasting life, for divine life. Death is an illusion. Death is a passage. Death is a tunnel. Beyond death, there is life. And this is the core of Jesus' message. He came to tell us, you are called to be participants of divine life, eternal life. Otherwise, the gospel is not just a moral message. The gospel is good news. Good news. Death does not exist. We are called to eternal, everlasting, divine life. If this message is deeply rooted in us, then we look at evil, suffering, death with another vision. It changed completely. This is what I call theosis. And a man like Matthew Fox was a Dominican priest from San Francisco, California, as far as I remember. And instead of speaking of original sin, he speaks of original blessing. Original blessing. You may tell me there is an original sin. I answer, but Jesus came, yes. And he redeemed us, yes. And we got his life in us, yes. And then, original sin has been suppressed by the blessing, where sin has abound, grace has superabound. I mean that we think that sin and grace are on the same level. No. The victory of Christ means that sin finished, over, kaput. Otherwise, our faith in Christ is just false. We think that the sin still exists in us. We are blessed. We are redeemed. We are saved. Christ's life is in us. And this is what I call theosis. And modern psychology, people like Carl Jung, Rogers, other modern psychologists clinically discovered that deep down in the human soul, deep down in my being, I am a good person. I'm safe. Salvation is not something which is to come. We are saved. We are good. Of course, there is in us a layer of selfishness, egoism, pride, sensuality, hate, refuse of the others, and all kinds of bad things in me. But this is one layer of my being, deeper than that, deeper than what we call evil. Deeper than evil is grace, divine life in me. If we have this vision, myself is completely different, and my vision to the people around me is totally different. The worst people around you, the worst people in history, deeper than the evil they commit, they are pure, good. The goodness of man. I believe in the goodness of man. Each of you here, you are good people. Even when you shout, even when you hate, even when you are greedy, even deeper than that, you are good people. And the people around you, if you look at them, that way, in believing in the goodness of man, man becomes good. I repeat it. When you believe in the goodness of man, this belief changes him into good. When your enemy comes to you shouting, wanting to crush you, hating you, look at him with a smile and with love. You desire him. Just to tell you a story, when I was caring of young boys in the Jesuit school in Cairo, one of the boys called Marco, he was born with a handicap. He could not walk, he could not play football, soccer with his classmates. And he was sitting in the bench, looking at them and boiling inside. And so, as a revenge, he was pulling their ear or their cheek. And they were complaining, Marco is doing that. Marco, I brought Marco. Marco, why are you doing that? Said he. He did not answer. He was hating the world, hating people because he could not play with his classmate. He was not normal boy. So, but once when they complained about him, I told him, Marco, come to my office. He came, I closed the door, and he was expecting me to shout at him. I took him in my arms, and I told him, Marco, you are so good. You are so tender. Deep down in you, you are a good boy. Tears and tears. Found somebody who trusted in him, found his essential goodness, his essential goodness. I revealed him his essential goodness, and in revealing it to him, he became good. He lost his self-defense attitude. Man understood me. Trust in man, trust in the human being, trust in your husband, trust in your wife, trust in your children, trust in the people around you. Trust that man is good. Trust that something good is coming. Trust in the power of Christ's salvation, Christ's resurrection, Christ's redemption. Trust, believe. And this is my deep feeling. My feeling is that we are moving towards a wonderful world, sometimes in the frame of our Arab Spring, as they call it, which is the Arab winter now. called hope. Because optimism can be just a human attitude. You have an optimistic character, then you are optimistic by nature. No, I am optimistic by my faith. And my optimism is called hope. Because I believe in redemption. I believe in Christ. I believe in grace. I have a book, All is Grace. The last chapter of it gives a title to the book, All is Grace. All is blessed. Whatever happened in your life, believe me, is a blessing. Suffering, disease, death, failure, whatever happens, and each of us experiences these periods of negative experience, believe that God's grace, Christ's grace, is strong. Theosis is summed up in one sentence, which concentrate and condense the thinking of the first centuries, thinking of the father of the church. And this sentence is from Athanasius of Alexandria, my city. He said, God has become man in order that man could become God. God became man so that man can become God. Yes, we are called to be God, to be God. And when they criticized Jesus, telling him, you made yourself God, you are just a human being, he said, is it not written in your book, in your scripture, that you are God's? And not only Jesus has this feature of being the Son of God, but all of us, we are sons and daughters of God, we are God's children. He is by nature, we are by grace and adoption, that is the same. What Jesus is by his very nature, we are by grace. Call it adoption if you want. So, in looking at me, Jesus can say, this is my beloved Son, in whom I put all my pleasure, my happiness. What he said about Jesus, this is my beloved Son, remember, he said it three times during his baptism, in the day of transfiguration, and the third time in his life, this is my beloved Son. He said it to whom? To Jesus, yes? But he said it to me. Theosis means that each of us is the only Son of God. He said, but the only Son of God is Jesus. But I am Jesus. In looking at me, he looks to me as his only Son. I have a book in French, does not exist here. L'amour fou de Dieu, crazy love of God. I discovered once in my life, it was a grace. I discovered once that for God, I am unique in the world. I am his beloved and only Son. He cherishes Mystics is the discovery of my uniqueness and the deep relationship, love relationship between me and God. He put me at his own level. And we speak about Islam today in the shadow of Moses. This is our message to Islam and to our brothers called Muslims, to reveal them that we are not slaves or servants. We are sons and daughters of men, of God. We are children of God. Oh, incredible. I am God's child. I'm not God's slave. And this is why I criticize sometimes in the church or in the prayer. Look at your servants. No! He said, I don't call you anymore servants. I call you children. Why are you changing? I wrote a letter to the Pope in 2007. You can find it in internet or in my site. Telling him, the language of the church should be changed. Many concepts, many theologian concepts, thinking, vision should be changed according to the gospel. You may tell me the teaching of the church is not in accordance with the gospel. I say, yes, but this generation is no longer understanding the language of the church, outmoded. We have to reformulate, to rethink theology, the dogmas. And this is what we are called to do nowadays. And I was speaking about Islam, shadow of Moses. I am living with Muslims all year in Alexandria. I'm running the Jesuit Cultural Center of the Jesuits in Alexandria. And my mission is to put the human being at the center of their vision. Many times I say, if Islam is the religion of God, Christianity is the religion of man. Of course, Jesus came to reveal us the Father, but Jesus also came to tell us that we are his children. When you pray, say, our Father. We don't say, Allahu Akbar, God is great. No, we say, our Father. Last month I was in the train between Alexandria and Cairo, and in front of me, a man was playing with his child on his lap, and the child was pulling his ear and pulling his nose and joking with him, and the father was happy and tapping on his cheek. And I said, a father, a human father, is behaving that way with his child, why not me with God? You may say, oh no, God, don't play with him that way. It's a shame. It's a sin. No. Theosis means that we are God's children. Just when you meet God, pull his ear, pull his nose, tap on his cheek. This is what we call being familiar with God. Familiar. He's our father, he's our mother. Being familiar would change your whole life. Theosis is that. He put us on his level. It's like a child which is, who is so small, and he pulls the pants of his father. Papi, I want to see the match of soccer match. And the father takes him and puts him on his shoulder. Oh, now I see better than you. You see here, I see from up. Redemption for me is that the fantastic good news that we have been pulled from our level, the human level, down to earth, on the shoulders of God, and he said, now you are higher than me. You see better. Fantastic. So, this divinization of man is the core of the gospel. The core of the gospel, the good news. When we say we have to spread the gospel, to evangelize our time, our society, what do we mean by to evangelize? What do we mean? To preach the gospel? Nobody would listen. Nobody would be interested in listening to you. To preach the gospel, to distribute gospels. You could do it. The evangelical church is doing it. Okay, I'm not against. But to evangelize is to reveal to people they are God's children, that God is God, that God is Father, that God is with us, that through incarnation, God has become man in order that we are now one with him. The revelation of the gospel is God is from now on Emmanuel. Emmanuel, God with us. God with us. More than that, God in us. Actually, I want to tell you something. This divine nature of man has been discovered with the Hindu, by the Hindus. In Hinduism, you have in the Vedanta and the Upanishad, the holy scriptures, this revelation that the deepest nature of man is God. And it is summed up in one sentence, you are that. You are that. And what is that? That is the supreme reality. That nature, the divine nature, has been discovered by the Hindus in the holy scriptures. And when Jesus tells us that we are sons and daughters of God, other people have discovered it. Because from the very beginning we have been created as the image of and likeness of God. It's in the Bible, from the very beginning. Each human being, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, atheist, whatever, he is the image of God. And theosis implies that when we look at the face, the human face, for me the human face is the highest this means this is Jesus, suffering Jesus today. I don't need to go to the church or to make a way of the cross or to get 2,000 years behind. Jesus is here. I was sick and you came to me. I was hungry and you have nourished me. So these words of Jesus mean that the normal person I meet in the street, in my house, whenever or wherever, is a revelation, God's revelation. Now, some mystics in Islam have discovered this reality. I spoke about Hinduism, but in Islam, a man like Al-Hallaj, one of the greatest mystics in Islam, he said, I am God. I'm God. Because he discovered in himself this divine presence, to the point that he was saying, like Jesus said, I and the Father are one, he said, I'm God. Of course, they crucified him, because they considered this a blasphemy. Another one also, Bistami, a Muslim mystic, they knocked at his door and he said, come in. They opened the door and he said, whom are you looking for? They said, Bistami. He said, there is no Bistami here, there is only God. Meaning by that he was God. God has taken his place, the place of his personality, of his identity. Our deeper identity is divine. Many people, and I come this to the last point, the secular society in which we live, I make a connection between that. The secular society is a discovery of man's power, man's dignity. The depth of what we call modernity, the modern age, which started in the 15th century, the Renaissance, and the Reformation, and after that, of Camus, and is the discovery of man's nature, of man's power, of man's dignity, of man's rights, human rights. The centrality of man. And it looks like there is a kind of opposition between God or man. And people think, and even good Christians like you and me, thinks that the more God is God, the less man is man. Because God has power in us. And the more I develop myself, I affirm myself, I grow and develop my person, my personality, my person, my knowledge, my power in the world, the more God is angry. Man wants to become like God, like me, is angry. It's exactly the opposite. Exactly the opposite. The more I grow, the more I become He says, the glory of God is man fully alive. Gloria Dei vivens homo. Gloria Dei vivens homo. The glory of God is the man fully alive, fully developed, fully himself, trusting in himself. So there is no opposition, as though the more I am myself, the less God is God. So we are on the same level, kind of fight, position, rivalry between me and God, man and God. But Christianity tells us not to worry. The rest of the same level. The more you grow, the more you grow, the more God is growing. The more you develop, the more God is glorified and happy. It's exactly like a father or a mother when they see their son or daughter succeeding, developing, furthering themselves, educated, better than they were. They're happy, they're not jealous. We put some human feeling in God. He cares for us. He wants us to be down. No. I look at God in his face because I'm not his rival. I'm not his opponent. This changes completely life. And this is our answer to the secular society in which we live. Secular society thought that man to become man should exclude God. And he has excluded God because of God presented to him in the past was a kind of rival, opponent to himself. So this God threw him away. I don't like him, and they are right, because this God is not the true God. Secularism, atheism today, is a way for man to become himself, rejecting a wrong and false concept of God. In Egypt, where we have our revolution these days, and the last day of June, you may have real terrible confrontation between Egyptians. Just look at television in the 30th of month of June, you will see what's happening in Egypt. But in Egypt, many Muslims and Christians rejected religion and rejected God and are becoming atheists because religion for them was such weight, such an obstacle to become truly human, that they don't want any more either God or religion. It is a new phenomenon in Egypt, totally new, especially in Islam and even in Christianity. The Egyptian people is very, very religious, whether Christians or Muslims. And this phenomenon of atheism and agnosticism in Egypt nowadays is very surprising. But I'm not surprised. And when they tell me, what do you think of this atheist coming to Egypt? I say, I'm happy. Say, you're happy. You're a priest. You're a man of God. You're happy about atheism. Yes, because the God they are rejecting is not my God, is not the true God, is not the God of Jesus Christ, is not the God of the Gospel. in a certain sense, the secular world nowadays, to find himself, modern men to find themselves need, in a certain sense, to reject and react against former religion, former God, who was too much for him a burden, an obstacle to become himself. For instance, in French Canada, more than in British Canada, in French Canada, starting from 1964, you had a kind of rejection of the Catholic church, old faith, because faith has not helped many people to be themselves, to be free. God wants us to be free. I have put freedom here. The gospel is good news of God, of human freedom. Become free. Free in front of others, free in front of God. And this is why Christian faith has something to say now, to go beyond the reaction and beyond the rebellion against the church. And the church herself should understand that this is a normal reaction of any teenager against his father and mother, his parents. I don't want any authority on me. I want to be myself. I want to be free. Please, let me alone. Okay. Nowadays, Canada is little by little recovering and discovering that there is another God. Actually, we have to discover the true God. You may tell me, we know him. Are you sure that the God you believe in, that the God you adore, you worship, is a true God? Is the God of the gospel? Is the God of Jesus? Is the God who frees man? Who lets him acquire his whole capacity? This is the message of theosis today for the Muslim world, for the secular world. This is the good news of the gospel for today.